A very warm welcome. Thank you so much for joining us. You are watching The Big Idea right here on Look Up TV. In the last 1 year, the world has been fighting with the COVID-19 pandemic that has wreaked havoc in very many countries. And now we are fighting with the third possible wave in Kenya. And as we have been looking at COVID-19, there are some diseases that have been forgotten, if I may say. And today we want to talk about those other illnesses that are still here with us. With me on set is Susan Mairimu.
Thank you.
Who is an HIV advocate and a patient as well. And on the other end, David Ochola, who is an HIV educator. Welcome, lady and gentlemen, to the conversation.
Thank you so much.
And we are in the third wave, COVID-19. And just before the show, we were talking about how, you know, we don't want to die.
Sure.
Like, death is sad.
Yeah.
Whoever, if you're up here or you're a low income earner, it hurts just the same way.
Sure.
So, but we have had the pandemic in the last 1 year, but we still have people dying from other conditions.
Yes.
So do you feel, Susan, that some diseases have been shelved just for the last 1 year?
Well, as much as, COVID is a disaster right now, and the worst scenario is because it's very hard to control it or manage it. But the good thing with HIV, you can manage it. But as much as we are focusing on COVID, we should also focus on other ailments that would trigger the death once you're infected with COVID-19. Mm-hmm. For example, HIV. I would really think what people should focus on is, as long as your viral load and your immune system is very guarded, then you're good to go. But you know, like, we need to emphasize on that, because that's what people don't know. Because if your immune system is low, definitely it's like somebody who has diabetes, so it will just come knocking you down. Mm-hmm. So as much as we are talking about COVID-19, let's talk about people living with HIV. How can they protect them so that their immune system is guarded, so that in case of any infection, it will not put them down?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay, maybe just take us through when COVID-19 first hit last year in our country, the first case was reported in March.
Mm-hmm.
And now, since then, people who have pre-existing conditions were put at the most risk,
mm-hmm,
of being put down with the virus.
Mm-hmm.
So what was it like for you at that time when you just heard that COVID is going to be very lethal on people in pre-existing conditions?
It was really scary. And what scenario, I got it in July last year. You know, when you first heard about it, and people with underlying ailments, I knew I was in that fear of you've battled. Like, for me, I had full-blown AIDS. I battled back to HIV, and then COVID is here. You know, you're scared. You've conquered one thing, and then something else is here to put you down. It's really discouraging. It's really scary. So around July, I got COVID last year. But you see, that's why I was saying it's good when you guard your immune system, because by then my viral load was undetectable, but I was taking zinc and vitamin C and stuff. But you see, it almost took me down because it was serious.
Mm-hmm.
So there's that fear of, like, I'm going to die. I mean, if I didn't have HIV, maybe it wouldn't be this bad. So it's a very scary scenario, but I thank God I came through. But it's a really a sad scenario that I wouldn't want anyone to go through.
Mm-hmm.
So I know everyone who's living with HIV is scared, because you know that for a fact, because of your underlying issues, you could be next on the line.
Mm-hmm.
But what I would just tell people, do vitamin C, omega-3 tablets, zinc, try and boost your immune system as much as possible, adhere to your medication diligently, and that's when septrin comes in.
Mm-hmm.
You see, like, when your viral load is undetectable, you don't need the septrin, because it's just a strong antibiotic that helps you counterattack other ailments.
Mm-hmm.
But see, at that point I had stopped taking septrin, but now I'm taking them because I know at least it will help me guard my immune system.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. And David, there have been efforts to, you know, to spread the message and get people aware of the HIV. And we even have a vision by 2030 that HIV would not be a threat. And we are slowly gaining in terms of just the reach out. So at the time when COVID hit Kenya, the efforts to sensitize people, were they affected?
they were not affected because, you know, when COVID-19 came in, the people shifted their more effort in COVID-19. And that's why in last year, in the 1st December, there was a campaign which to emphasize that as much as we fight COVID-19, let us not forget HIV. Because if you look at the statistic which came out, it was identified that 15 to 24, they were the largest people to get HIV. Because most of the people, we focus on the COVID-19 and we forgot about HIV. And that's why there's a campaign which started in the 1st on December, which when we separated about the HIV day. So people say that we should not forget about HIV. As much as we focus on COVID-19, we should not forget about HIV. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's why we always emphasize telling people, as much as we wear our mask, let us not forget to wear our condom. Because at this time of the COVID-19, many parents, they are looking for a food to put into the table. They don't have that time to have a conversation with their children. You know, the time where there was a lockdown, they were at home. People lost their jobs. There were the issue of GBV that came in, you see. So there were a lot of issues that came out. So you found that parents were looking for something to put into the table. So they didn't have that time to have a conversation with their...
So the focus then was different.
It was different.
Because it's about survival.
Until people... The rise of the HIV infection raised people's mind. Say, oh... Kumbe, we are focusing mostly on COVID-19 and we are forgetting about the HIV. And that's why there's a campaign which started on 1st December about the let us not forget about HIV as much as we fight about COVID-19. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, and in January there was a report by the Ministry of Health about the surge of HIV cases in 15 counties. And what was different about it was that it was not just, you know, we are used to the Nyanza region having the most number of cases, mm-hmm. but now this time it was Marsabit, Kajiado. So more counties have now higher cases of HIV. So what really happened during this COVID-19 pandemic?
As per my thinking, as my colleague said here, first because, you know, the schools were closed. Like most teens, like were at home, and you know the infection rate even in the teens has gone up very high. So like the parents are not there to guide you or tell anything, they're busy doing other things. You're at home, you're not sticking in the house, you're exposed outside there. You know, we had cases of, you saw sex orgies and stuff. Mm-hmm. You know, these kids do not know, like you're supposed to protect yourself, you're not supposed to even to engage yourself in sex at that point in life. Mm. Then some of them were engaging in drug use, you know, injections and stuff. So you're seeing the risk is high. And then there's the desperation of maybe, as he was saying, most people lost their jobs. Like, let's assume the people who work in the hotel industry, you know, and stuff, you know, you have children to feed, you have rent to pay. Mm. So you reach a point where you're very desperate because you don't have anything to do and you subject yourself to maybe, let's say, sexual trade and stuff. You know, and then there's also depression and stress. Mm-hmm. You know, you might go there, just have a drink, because you want to get stress out, you engage with someone, you didn't test, you don't know the status of that person. So you can imagine there's a lot that has been happening just because of COVID, because of lack of jobs. It has gone really high, and my biggest worry is not even with the grown-ups, but with the teens. Because as much as in schools there's sex education, you know, they just take it in school because we have to do it, but they don't know the reality outside there, what is happening. Mm-hmm. There's the issue, as you were talking about, sexual gender-based violence. You know, like people get raped, people, like we have adults raping kids in the house, you know, like uncles and what have you.
And it has increased a lot, especially during the pandemic.
Exactly. And you think these people have time to think about protection? They don't. That adult knows very well, maybe they know their status, or they don't know. So you can imagine the rise of infection has gone very high. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And David, even looking at, you spoke about condoms, and how has the distribution been like even now during this time of the pandemic? Because we know with the lockdown, there's just the channels have been a little bit interrupted. So what is the message that you're sending out there now to people in terms of sensitizing them?
Mostly we sensitize, telling them the importance of the condom use. Even some of the facility, they have youth-friendly clinic where it only specific for youth. You know, youth, they cannot mix up with the adult people. So when there's a special clinic, there's a special place where when a youth comes in the facility, everything that he needs is always provided. Another thing about condom use, you know, in this epidemic, most of the youth didn't come in the facility. You know, there was this motion where some of the facility were closed because some few of the healthcare workers were found to be HIV, they were found to be positive in the COVID-19. Mm-hmm. So some facility were closed. So this youth didn't get the opportunity to come into the facility to get the condoms. Also, even if the facility were open, so many youth, so many people outside, they feared coming to the facility because they knew, if I come to the facility, I can get the COVID-19. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And just looking at young people and contracting the HIV or being at risk of contracting HIV. Mm-hmm. So the message has been put out there for quite a long time. So what are the efforts now that we can just make? How different can we approach it? Because young people are... they're the same.
Yeah.
They're not changing their ways. I don't know if I'm considered young, but young people, young people are not really changing their ways. So what is the different message that now we should be sending out right now?
I think the major issue is ignorance, especially, you know, the younger people, we are talking about teens, we are talking about young adults. This, and even adults, there is a lot of ignorance. As I was telling him, we have this notion that somebody who's HIV positive is supposed to be sickly. You cannot be looking good like this and healthy and you're HIV positive. So the message that we still should go out there, more of us activists should go out there and tell people, you know what? Most people are very healthy and most will not go and tell you that they are like this. So what we need now to emphasize is protection, as he's talking about condoms, but also mass testing. We need to test. I keep on telling people, if I tested positive, if I had gone to test, I wouldn't be positive today. Though I'm not complaining, I'm okay the way I am. Mm-hmm. Because we have this ignorance of you get used to someone using protection, and then at one point you stop it. But you don't know this person was dating who, and the other person maybe might have exposed them, or you yourself. Mm-hmm. So we need to emphasize more on testing. Because I'm thinking, as much as we're using protection, we have that notion that mezoeana na nakako healthy. So, I mean, why would I even bother myself? So I think testing is more important, mass testing is more important than as much as condoms come in handy. That's the message that we should tell people. And we should stop that notion of judging people by their looks. Because most of us, almost half of the country is HIV positive. Mm-hmm. But it's just because of stigma, people are not coming out and saying, hello, I'm taking my meds, you know? So we need to first know, like, it's your responsibility as a person to take care of your sexuality, to make sure you're protecting the other person and test. I think that's the message, as per me, that's the message that should go outside there.
Okay. Yeah. And if you're just looking at the attitude towards testing for young people, like where I went to campus, we used to have a health week. So during the health week, we would test different ailments from pressure, diabetes, HIV. So this is what people would do. They go test for diabetes, pressure, every other thing, even cervical cancer. But HIV, the tent is over there. No one is going there. So there's this attitude. What are people, the fear?
You know, some young people say they rather die what they don't know, you see. So they say, I rather live on, let me continue with my life without knowing my status, because they know, if I know my status, There are so many myths about HIV out there. People say, you know, if you get HIV, you'll die. If you get HIV, yeah? And I know so many people that have associated HIV with immoral, you see? Mm-hmm. They don't know there are so many ways of one can transmit HIV. Mm-hmm. It's not only sexual transmission. There are so many ways someone can get HIV. So there are this attitude that young people have about HIV that we need it, really need to talk to them. Another thing about, I want to tell parents out there, just talk to their children about sex. Sex is the reality. Mm-hmm. And let me tell you one thing, young people cannot abstain. That's the thing we must know. Young people cannot abstain.
So you mean that's impossible?
That is the reality. Uh-huh. And let me tell you one thing, nowadays you can get a 9-year-old girl know all about sex. You see, you can let a 15-year-old boy know everything about sex. You see, even there's a story I heard about, there was a group of students, they were in a room doing a group sex. You see, they are drinking. And the moment you drink, you're not in your sober mind to use protection, you see. So there's this conversation parents, they're trying to ignore, talking to their children, they're so busy. No, we are talking tomorrow. So these parents need to take up the action. To calm down, talk to their children about sex. This is the reality some parents, they are trying to ignore, and it's the reality.
You know, most of our parents, they grew up in a time where abstinence is what was preached the most. And if you are from a Christian family, even here we are a Christian background, so what we advocate for is abstinence. But then again, there is the reality. Mm-hmm. Of what's really happening. So with so much exposure right now, mm-hmm. then times have changed.
For sure.
So then the conversation becomes different.
It comes different. Even if you see the media today, the song people are singing, they're normalizing sex. If you see, there's a girl I know, each time it's about sex. Eh? The plot where I live, you find Amanda Nomano Mugine, another time, when I'm changing men like a cloth, you see. And I see, you know, when I do my research, I found out, you know, children, they follow what their parents do, you see. So when, you know, when a child grows up, he imitates from their parents. Yeah. So what they see from their parents, they will do. There's another scenario where a father, it's just a single room, a father and a mother. They have come when they are drunk. They wash themselves in front of their children. They do sex in front of their children. When their children are growing, they know sex is a normal thing. You see, so there are things even parents we do, we must be careful. Mm-hmm. Because their children, our children are looking after us. They're looking at you as their parents because yeah. they know, you know, parents are second God. If you see, the way you'll walk is the way your child will walk. The step you'll take, the step
will always imitate.
So it's very good now to change. Now the parent to have a conversation about sex. That's the reality it is. Because if we ignore this thing, HIV will not end. Because HIV to end is for all of us to put our hands together. And always school to introduce about things of sex education in school. Talk to these children about their sex, about their health. You know, a girl is growing up. That adolescent stage where her body changes and everything. This girl doesn't have anyone to talk to this girl, knowing, you know, this changes comes when you feel like this, you need to do this. You see, this thing is fun from his peers. Mm-hmm. Oh, now you are so smart, you know. So I didn't know, you see. So there are some things we need to put into place. Like sex education should be mandatory and a must in school, even in our homes, it should be started. And I always believe education starts in the house. So it is the responsibility of our parents to start a sex conversation. Yeah, with
charity
children.
Begins at home.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, so then it means that we all really have to be responsible.
For sure.
If we want to end the threat of HIV mm-hmm. by 2030.
Mm-hmm.
So, and now with COVID-19, the gains that we had made in terms of course, sensitizing and just getting the ARVs to people, there is an impending shortage of the ARV medication. Mm-hmm. So, Susan, has that affected you?
Yeah, not that much, I wouldn't say. You know, I was even discussing with him. I think first it varies with where you're, the facility that you're going, because the most facilities at shortage are government mm-hmm. and dispensary related, you know, facilities. But like for me, I go to LVCT Hurlingham, but I'm affected because, you know, at this point I've been taking my meds for 6 months. So now I've been given for 3 months until the shortage is over. So there's a lot of, rumors mm-hmm. surrounding these issues. They're saying they have not paid taxes for it and stuff. But what I just need to say that the government needs to do something about it, because I am in a certain support group, and you told, like, somebody goes to KNH, given meds for 1 month. You see, KNH is a big hospital, so you can imagine the patients are so many. So for them to provide for anyone, they've reached a point they are giving one team per person. Mm-hmm. So that clearly tells you there's a problem. Our worry is, as much as there are angles up there, they need to consider people are like us. Like, there's something that people don't understand. If you miss your medication for just 24 hours, the virus starts multiplying. It mutates to something else, and then your medication fails. Now you have to start all over time. It will take like different kind of medications mm-hmm. for you to get back to where you were. So, you know, it's going to affect us. So they really need to understand it's a serious issue, and they need to make sure that we get our medications back.
Okay.
Because clearly we are right now, everyone is scared. You know, like for us, we have hope. But there's that person down there who thinks it's the end of us. Mm-hmm. We are going to die. So the government, as much as they are focusing on COVID, could they kindly also focus on us people living with HIV? We need our medications mm-hmm. as soon as possible. Whatever issues, whatever the wrangles are, they need to sort it out so that everybody gets their medication. Because if it continues like this, what happens in the next 3 to 4 months? We are going to a complete shortage.
Mm-hmm.
And then what happens? All of us are just going to go like that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because this medication is what holds you, suppresses the virus. So tell me, if you, after every 24 hours, you're supposed to take another one, what happens when you don't have any medication to take? So we are really crying out for the government to do something about it.
Okay.
Yeah.
And looking at even people, the low-income earners, mm-hmm. and those who wait for the government to come to their aid because they receive the free medication, then even the USA company, PEPFAR, that used to supply a lot of these ARV medication in the country, started just downsizing because of course of the distribution, mm-hmm. manufacturing. With the COVID-19, it has stalled a lot of processes. So then people who are the low income earners, then so they're supposed to be the priority right now. Because if then they miss their medication, then what? We are looking at one pandemic and another pandemic again. So then how can we cushion them?
What I can advise the government is to come out and put things straight, because so many people's lives depend on these ARVs. And let me tell you one thing, when there's a shortage or they say there's no more ARVs, we'll be up to disasters in our country. Because as my sister said, when you don't take your ARVs well, there's that ARVs, the HIV start multiplying. And when it start multiplying, you don't have the immunity in your system goes down.
Mm-hmm.
At the moment it goes down, even that COVID-19, it's very easy to take you down.
Sure.
So I add the government, as much as they are focusing on COVID-19, let them not forget about HIV, because there are so many innocent people that are depending on these ARVs.
Mm-hmm.
Look at that child who is 1 year old. Look at that boy who is 10 years old. He's so innocent. He doesn't know anything about this story. So I ask the government to come out, try their best, because at the moment they forget about HIV, there will be another big disaster mm-hmm. in this country.
Okay.
So I urge the government to come out, try their best to at this issue that we are having right now. Yeah.
Okay.
And I'm encouraging all people living with HIV that they do not lose hope. Let us focus, take your medication until otherwise stated.
Okay.
Yeah.
And the big question we are asking you today, are we fighting then two pandemics, COVID-19 and HIV, which has seemed to be taking a back seat in terms of the government efforts? We are taking a short break here on The Big Idea, but we'll be back joining the conversation. Welcome back. You are watching The Big Idea right here on Look Up TV. And today in the program, we are talking about COVID-19 pandemic and the strain it has put on other illnesses, other chronic illnesses, and specifically HIV/AIDS. With me on set is Susan Wairimu, who is an HIV activist, and on the other end we have David Ochola, who is an HIV educator. And the big question we are asking you today, has the government forgotten about the other chronic illnesses, and specifically HIV? Are we now looking at two pandemics awaiting to happen? And so, ladies and gentlemen, we were talking about the effects of COVID-19 pandemic. It has strained different sectors, and now health is the most important, because if we don't have our health in check, then health is wealth. Yeah. Mm-hmm. We have to be okay for us actually to even revive the economy. Mm-hmm. But now, looking at the numbers of COVID-19, which are now surging, and HIV infections that are increasing as well, we have seen scenarios where people who are HIV positive have not been able to go to hospitals for the fear. You know, there was a lot of misinformation mm-hmm. earlier about you go get exposed, then we could possibly just die.
Yeah.
So about the strategic communication, has the government maybe failed in terms of strategic communication, because people are still scared to go to hospitals, get tested, get medication?
Okay, before we talk about the government, what I like about the facilities is they've come up with measures to control their people on how to get their medication and stuff. You'll find like at KNH, people like used to go and just stay in one hall, but now you have like to stay, like they have forms outside, you go by numbers, where you the social distancing and everything. If you're very far, they just send someone, like other facilities have courier services, they just dispatch your medication. Like where I go to LVCT, what we do is they give you appointments. You have to come as per the timing you're given, mm-hmm. so that you take at the right time and then you just go. So for the facilities, they're really working hard to make sure people are not exposed, the social distancing and everything is done as per the guidelines okay. of MOH. As with the government, as we said before, I think they have shifted everything to COVID, that they've forgotten there's HIV here. So they are not like really emphasizing on how to see people are protected and everything. So it's like everybody are being just told to social distance. If it's not a must, you shouldn't go to this place. Mm-hmm. So the government needs to come out and tell us, like, this is what you guys should do. This is what, you know, because as you said, you see, there are people down there who are scared to go out there, who are scared, they know. You see, first, the poor people are not being cushioned. You cannot take your meds if you're not financially okay. You've lost your job. These meds are very strong, let me tell you. If you eat when you're hungry and weak, it can even make you collapse. Something that suppresses a virus for 24 hours is no joke.
It has to be strong.
It's a very strong medication. So imagine these people first, they don't have jobs, they've lost most of them. Because you see, a low income earner is somebody who works maybe at industry area. They work, they do manual jobs.
True.
They don't have jobs anymore. People who work like at EPZ, they've been reduced to like few people working. So you can imagine most people are at home, they don't have food, so they are actually fearing to take their medication because they can't like have a balanced diet or anything. Mm-hmm. So first, the government needs to cushion the low income earners who are HIV positive. They can even provide food, you know, like they can go and collect at their facilities, because you want to take your medication when you've eaten well.
On an empty stomach, exactly. It's a bit impossible.
Yes. And then it should also come up with other measures that will help HIV people, you know, like not get exposed to COVID. But again, it is hard. Everybody is at risk, remember.
True.
Whether you're HIV positive or HIV negative, I mean, like I would touch your phone and I'm exposed mm-hmm. and you're negative. you still get exposed. So everybody is at risk. So we all of us should follow the guidelines. The government should also emphasize that everyone is safe. Everyone is good to go. Like, I have an issue like with the lockdown. For example, when they reduce the timing, when people go at the stage in the evening, the coffee time is almost there. It's
so like crowded.
I live in Kitengela, for example. Mm-hmm. I live in Nairobi at 6 o'clock. We have to be crowded into one matatu so that everybody, you know, the matatu guys want to take everybody home. Yeah. They're being concerned.
They don't want to leave you
exactly
in town.
But are we looking at the risk right now because we have the third wave? So as much as the government is trying to, you know, to control COVID, they need to understand the measures, to look at the negative impact of the measures that, yeah? Because if you're HIV positive and you're dumped in that matatu, clearly you're prone to get infected.
True.
Yeah, so I think they just need to look at things seriously mm-hmm. before they just make any decisions because it's affecting everyone, yeah.
Okay, and David, well, what are some of the maybe different ways that you're reaching out to people who are HIV positive? Mm-hmm. Because as I had said earlier, some people do not want to go to hospitals. Maybe some people, even during lockdown, so it was even hard to access. So what is the kind of message now that you're sending out to them, even during this time of the pandemic?
So we are encouraging them to come to the facility. Another thing, you know, this COVID-19, when it came, now people are using different ways, this medicine to reach the people. There's a strategy called community refill ART, where healthcare worker takes the ARVs to the community so that to reduce the people who are coming to the facility to be congested. So there's a community ART refill where so many patients are being pushed to the community. Unless you are doing your VL, is the time you'll come to the facility. But at the rest of the month, your medicine or your ARVs is taken to the community. Unless you have a complication or about your health, you're not feeling good, is the time you come to the facility. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. And HIV infections, especially now in the 15 counties that were reported to have very high numbers during this time of the pandemic. So is the message there different? Has it been diversified?
You know the issue about this HIV, when they found, for example, in Nyanza, it is very high in HIV infection, most of the focus pushed on in that Nyanza. And that's why you see in the 15 counties, it came up to have the high HIV infection, because you know about this, you know, in HIV, a step goes by, the things are changing. You know, like back days, they were doing a mass testing, but nowadays there's something called partner notification services, where when someone get tested and it's positive, they're looking for their partners, sexual partners, mm-hmm. around her or him, so
trace.
That they can come to be tested for
okay.
HIV. So you find out that the rest, they're not being tested, because you know, as an organization or a donor, they come with their own ways how to handle things.
Mm-hmm.
So they found out, oh, this PNS is healing more HIV positive people. So their effort were in those PNS. Yeah.
Okay. Susan, you maybe, if you don't mind, you can take us through just when you got COVID-19,
mm-hmm.
the experience for you, what was it like?
It was a very scary experience. I started like a flu. And then I couldn't smell like anything. I couldn't taste anything. Like, it could give me chili and I couldn't even feel it. And everybody's like, eh, which kind of flu do you even have? You know, first, there's one thing that people also don't understand. COVID is a flu, but a very strong flu. So at first, everybody was like, eh, okay, this is a kawaida flu. So I also assumed it's a kawaida flu, but I've never experienced, you know, loss of smell and, you know, tasting. That's when I realized something is wrong. But I continued just doing concoctions of turmeric, ginger, and lemon. And then now when I started becoming sick, like I had a fever, a very serious persisting headache, joint pains, like you have malaria, fatigue. You know, that's when I realized something was very wrong, and I went and tested. So I decided to isolate myself because I couldn't afford. By then, you know, getting to the hospital was very expensive. Mm-hmm. So I decided to isolate at home. The worst case scenario is whereby you are alone. You don't know what to expect. You know whatever you're battling because of your condition, it could take you down any minute. There's that thing of like, my God, like I've come from so far. For me to die of something else, it's not fair, you know. I've worked hard to be where I am. So there are scenarios where at one point it affected my chest. I would feel like somebody's just thumping on, you know, like stepping on my chest like this. So I would like wake up in the morning, I mean at night, and boil the mwarobaini leaves and moringa and put some robe or something and like cover myself just to steam myself so that I'm able to breathe.
Inhale.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And I was on medication. They were treating all the symptoms. I was on very strong antibiotics. The inhaling helps a lot, actually. It does. Whether you have COVID-19 or not, at this point, doing the steaming is very important because it just helps your chest to be clear of any mucus and water view. Mm-hmm. But I will tell you, it wasn't a nice experience. You wake up at night and you realize this is the end, and you have just to beg God to give you another chance. Mm-hmm. This is something I would never wish anyone. You can imagine you're there in the hospital, you're in oxygen, and you're seeing your life drifting away. Trust you me, it's not a good experience to anyone. I wouldn't want anyone to go through that. Mm-hmm. I would just tell people who are living with other ailments, not HIV alone, to just guard the immune system, make sure they are taking things that are guarding the system, and following rules and certain sanitizing.
Okay. Yes. And you mentioned that your viral load was low.
Yeah, it was undetectable.
Okay.
So but I still got it.
But you still got it. So then this means when your immunity was pretty okay. So that
pretty
means,
much okay.
Okay.
Yes.
So then the immunity is what we really need to focus on.
Yes.
Okay.
Because most probably, you see now I have an underlying condition as much as my immunity is guarded. Mm-hmm. If at all a HIV negative person can get COVID, anybody is prone to get COVID. But you see, for the other person, because their immunity is okay, there's a probability they'll be okay, but for me I'll get sick. So what people need to focus, HIV positive people, focus on, if you cannot afford to buy the vitamins and omega, focus on foods that build the immunity. That is what is important. Mm-hmm. And again, the government needs to find out people living with HIV who are low income earners, how can they cushion them with food? Or even there's these vitamins for, I think, a shilling or 50 cents. They can buy that and, you know, give at the facilities so that they can be given. They need to protect the immune system. Mm-hmm. Because we will fight COVID, and as he was saying, then we realize people died of HIV.
Yeah.
While we were focusing on something
else.
You
look at more numbers here.
Exactly.
Than actually the COVID-19
yes.
pandemic.
Yes.
Okay. And the CAS Mwangangi yesterday mentioned that no HIV positive people would lack medication, even now that there's a shortage of the ARV medication. So she assured Kenyans, and especially the low-income earners who depend on government facilities to access this kind of medication. So has this already been affected?
I'm not sure, but I know when CS said that we should, that you have assured that the ARVs are around, and I believe they're around. Mm-hmm. So people living with HIV should not have any worry about it, because things are safe. And another thing I want to talk about lockdown. You know, when it happened, I believe some or many people who are living in HIV, some are being locked out in other counties.
Yeah.
And this is what happened. In that, when he was in, when he or she is in that county, he doesn't have a card to show that he or she is taking drugs. He doesn't have pills, you see. And you know what happened? There's a criteria when you need to have a refill in the another facility. You must have a card or the name of your ARVs. And if you know these low-income people or people living with HIV, not all people know the name of their ARVs. So you get, it's so challenging because most people, they lack pills. Do not take the medication, and when they are not taking their medication, their viral load will go high.
Mm-hmm.
At the moment they will go high, they are at very high risk to get COVID-19. So I'm appealing to the government and to the facility in the other county, in case they found a person living with HIV looking for a drugs or ARVs and he or she doesn't know, please, they can comply with other facility where he or she was taking the drug to help each other. Because this fight, if you focus mostly on COVID-19, we'll have another disaster on HIV. Mm-hmm. So let us work together, even in another facility, because I know there are some people living with HIV that have been locked down in the other county. So let us help together as we help these people living with HIV.
So they can get access to medication.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, and Susan, you mentioned that you are in a support group, because we know with the pandemic, then there's a lot of fear, even depression cases, anxiety, most reported mental health conditions during this time of the pandemic. And especially for people who have pre-existing conditions, people who have HIV, cancer, diabetes. Mm-hmm. So then it is a scary time.
Mm-hmm.
So for just the mental health, does the support group come in handy?
Okay, like, you know, we have different kind of support groups. There's support groups for dating. You know, there are those people who've not disclosed their status.
Mm-hmm.
So they can't just go dating anyhowly. They want to be somewhere they can date people who have the same status.
Mm-hmm.
So we have dating support groups, and then we have support groups of just encouraging people, education and everything.
Okay.
But you know, as much as we talk to them, most people are depressed right now. Because you see, you're not only depressed because you know it can affect you. You're depressed because you've lost a job. You're depressed because you can't bring a meal on the table and your kids are looking at you like this.
Mm-hmm.
You're depressed because your landlord does not understand you don't have a job, because they also need money. It is not their fault.
It's a business for them.
Exactly. So, you know, we can't complain. We say to the landlord is a part, because they also need that money. So mental health issues right now are on the rise, because that's why you see there's a lot of killing, fighting, whatever, because people are strained a lot.
Mm-hmm.
So at least when they come to those support groups, you know, even when you joke around and somebody shares the experience and then another person shares, then you realize, oh, so actually I'm not the only one who's going through this. And you know, it's not only the low income earner. Like, for example, I'm a business person. I sell makeup and shoes and clothes, ladies' stuff. I've been affected since last year. And you can imagine now this lockdown again. You see, this is not an essential service.
Mm-hmm.
I would not come and buy shoes and leave food. I need to buy food. Remember, the prices of fuel had gone up. Food had gone up.
Mm-hmm.
So you can imagine, even me, who's doing well, things have changed totally for me. You need to go back to your pocket and pay rent. You need to buy food. Remember, as much as HIV is a normal condition, there are foods that we emphasize on people to eat a balanced diet.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
yeah.
So you need to go an extra mile to make sure you're eating well,
mm-hmm.
to make sure you're drinking a lot of fluids and water and stuff. And you can imagine most places we don't get clean water. You need to buy clean water to drink. I can afford. Is somebody down there who cannot afford clean water to drink? So it's a scenario whereby it's really affecting most people. So if it's affecting me, what about that person? So when they come to those groups, we encourage them, we tell them, even us, we are going through the same thing. At times, if we realize somebody is not doing well, we fundraise for them, we buy food,
mm-hmm.
or we look for organizations dealing with HIV that give out food, we connect them, and they get food. So that's what we do. The good thing about people living with HIV, they are very connected, we love each other, and we really support each other.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't matter if you know somebody physically, but if we're always there for each other. That's the most important thing.
That's good.
Yes.
So, David, is it the same when now you're reaching out to people during this time when people have fear, a lot of fear?
Yeah.
Because death is now becoming a reality. You're like, I could be next.
For sure.
Yes.
So, you know, nowadays, because of the COVID-19 restriction, so mostly we find ourselves, or we meet ourselves mostly in online WhatsApp group, Telegram, mm-hmm. Facebook, and as she said, most of us, or people living with HIV, they're well connected. Because I remember there was a Give Direct which they were giving to young people living with HIV. Most of the young people benefited, and they were getting around 4K for 3 months. Those people are getting 3,004 for 4 months.
Mm-hmm.
So it really helped them. If we get, as she said, when you hear, like, there's this place that are giving food, we refer them. Another thing, we started a movement called Smart Up Organization, where we came up with a welfare kit where at least we can accommodate everyone. Where if you have an issue, you can come out. There are people who are so loving. They will share like 100 shillings, 200 shillings just to support you. Yeah. So there are so many people, there are so many things that we are doing just to support people living with HIV so that they can move another step forward. Even we have a timetable. I was up, which has a timetable where there's a mental health and issue. Okay. Where if you have any issue, you can raise and refer you to a psychologist or a counselor. Another thing in KNH, there's a counseling center where they are dealing with young people 15 to 24. It's a free of charge. If you have any issue that you are going through and you don't know where to go, KNH is a place to go. It's free of charge. You can get a psychology where he or she can help you.
Okay. Yeah. And even as we conclude, we know that HIV is not the only condition that Kenyans are struggling with. We have over 30,000 deaths from cancer annually. And we also have a killer disease, which is malaria. Mm-hmm. It wreaks havoc across the country, especially in the areas of Baringo. So then there are other ailments as well. So just to pick your thoughts as we conclude, have we then neglected these areas, and then what can we do then as a society, as the government?
What I would want to say as we conclude, first we need to understand HIV is not such a big deal, because it's manageable unlike other diseases, because once you take your meds, you eat well, you don't reinfect yourself, your viral load is constant at zero and you're good to go. First, people need to understand it's no longer a death sentence, or as he said, it's not shameful. So we need to focus on other things like malaria and other things. So when the government needs to do sensitization, mass testing, so that now we can shift focus on other killer diseases. And we need to remove that notion in people's minds that HIV is the biggest thing that we should be fighting here. We need things like cancer. You cannot manage cancer. So we need to work on HIV as much as possible, especially in the villages, so that we can now focus on other things.
Okay. Yeah. David, yes.
So what I can say as we conclude is just, as she said, HIV is not a big deal. And it's nowadays I always say it's not an issue. Mm. So let us, as he said, let us put more effort in other chronic diseases so that we can move forward. As she said, we have fought HIV for long. Now it's time as we continue, as we shift to other chronic diseases, it's time now for government and each and everyone. Let us help each other to fight this chronic disease as large. Because I always said, as an organization, it cannot fight alone. Government, it cannot fight alone. As individual, we cannot fight alone. But when we come together, as we come together and fight this chronic disease, we will win all together. And I'm sure when we put our hands together, sure we'll conquer COVID-19. Thank you so much.
Okay, and thank you, Susan Mwirimu and David Ochola, for being part of this conversation.
Thank you.
We have come to the end of The Big Idea right here on Big Cup TV. Today on the show, we have been talking about COVID-19 pandemic and HIV infection. I am Nancy Nalima. Thank you so much for watching.